So
great.
Now
he mentions Michael Bay. Geoffrey and I were just talking about how nice it is that these are not Michael Bay designs.
Yeah, the thing that's really cool about this Transformers game for us is the fact that it's the cartoon we watched when we were kids. It is not the Michael Bay version of it. It is not the new, more recent video game version of it, which is also pretty different.
Come in.
It's got this classic feel to it, which is really great.
The war for Cybertron games all take place on the aligned continuity.
The aligned continuity? What is that?
There's a couple different Transformers continuities. The War for Cybertron games, and there's like a novel, and the Transformers Prime 3-season series, and the current Transformers Robot in Disguise cartoon all take place within that continuity.
Okay. Which is separate from...
Well, like the traditional G1 continuity or the Marvel Comics continuity or the Dreamwave Comics continuity.
I love the comic. I used to read the Transformers. I missed a lot of stuff about Transformers, and I forgot most of what I knew.
Sure.
But I remember reading the comics, you know, the death of Optimus Prime, mm-hmm. and quadriplegic woman with all of the cybernetic stuff she'd built on her body so that she could basically stand toe-to-toe with the Transformers.
It's also worth noting that the cartoon continuity in America and Japan is the same for the first 3 seasons. And then America gets a 4th season that we only got here, and Japan gets Transformers Headmasters, which is a completely different show, including some fairly different character designs. And then continues on into Victory, or Master Force, and then Victory, and then some Japan-only comics and stuff. So even the continuities that are supposed to be one continuity wind up fracturing out and splitting into multiple continuities. The Transformers are a continuity nightmare.
So I've already learned the controls, which is nice. And this game was made by Platinum Games, which is they're known for doing really slick action games, and you can definitely feel it. It's I'm not feeling any like sort of hesitance using the controls. Everything feels like it works the way it should. But when I want to dodge, I dodge. When I want to jump or hit, I jump or hit. And there's no like sort of struggling to get the character to do what you want, which is sort of. I mean, you'd think that'd be very fundamental, but there's so many games that try to be action games and fail on that score.
So, a thing that I find one of my favorite things about Transformers. You mentioned that these look like the cartoon that we grew up with, and they're very close. They are, the character designs are definitely. That sort of Sunbow style of design. But something I actually really adore about Transformers is that there isn't one real right Optimus Prime. Because Optimus Prime, because of the history of where Transformers come from, is the toy first. They had the model for the physical toy before they had any character design. So like, what's the real Optimus Prime? Is it the toy? Is it the artwork on the toy? Is it the advertising? Is it the artwork that, I'm trying to think of his name, a Japanese mecha designer did? Is it the simplified versions of that artwork that Floro Derry came in and did? Floro Derry's a fascinating dude to look up, who's a talented artist who's also clearly pretty crazy and likes to post on the Transformers message boards and wikis and stuff, using fake names to talk about how great Floro Derry is.
That is
and
amazing.
Whenever anyone doesn't agree with him, he says it's because they're racist against Filipinos.
That sounds like the best.
Yeah. Like, who is it? The Marvel comic? Is it the show? I love that there isn't one true canonical, this is what he's supposed to look like, Optimus Prime.
So that gives, I mean, imagine that gives like new artists a lot of freedom. Like, well, no, in mine, Optimus Prime looks like this.
Yeah, you have the freedom to, you know, to do interpretations and bring some of your own flavor to the toy, or the figure, or the game, whichever one you're doing. Bumblebee says there's something over there. It's probably that glowing yellow dot.
There we go. So they're doing a great job of like of integrating my transforming capabilities. Like I do a bunch of normal things like ground slams and special attacks after a combo that could have been animated anyway, but they decide to animate me into a truck for those moments because there's a lot of periods in the game where there's not really a reason for me to be a truck. Driving around as a truck. There's certain times where that's appropriate, certain times where that's not, and especially in a sort of a level-based action game like this, instead of like an open-world game or something, I'm not always going to need to move at top speed across a city.
Right.
But so they find ways to excuses basically to work my truck form into my normal animations, my normal moveset. Right.
Which is great because turning into a truck is an important part of who Optimus Prime is.
Yeah. No. Stay focused.
That's a fun variation on the previous story. Okay.
Yeah. So I got to dodge right before an enemy attack, and then I can slow down time and make a difference here.
Which is a very Platinum Games mechanic. I dodged too soon. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of Transformers, because it's one of my favorite weird things. I love part of how the whole, there is no one true Optimus Prime comes out of the fact that Transformers, as an idea, start really at the 1983 Tokyo Toy Fair, where a rep from Hasbro is walking around the 1983 Tokyo Toy Fair, and he sees the Takara booth, and he sees these transforming robot toys from two different toy lines. He sees the Microman Change toy line, and Microman's gimmick as a toy line is that these characters are aliens who have come to Earth and are fighting a battle in secret, and
that's why they transform?
And that's why they transform, and that they're full size. So Microman figures are about this tall, and that's how big the aliens are. So they're fighting a war on our planet.
What do they transform into? Size.
So they transform into things like cassette decks and a gun. And
Is this where Megatron came from?
That's where Megatron comes from, and a microscope, and a camera. And yes, Transformers is absolutely a base cartoon to sell toys. So that's where that set of Transformers come from. Bumblebee's actually from that set. Bumblebee is a toy car that transforms into a robot. That's why he doesn't scale at all with any of the other cars. And then the other line is the Diaclone car robot line. And I strongly recommend, there's a great video on YouTube of old Diaclone commercials, which are all these great, stop motion and wires off screen commercials of the toys flying around and transforming. And every Diaclone ads ends with the great announcer voice going, Diaclone. It's great. So you have these two separate toy lines at Takara, and Hasbro goes, oh, let's license these, smash them together.
So in Japan, these were actually just separate properties.
And these were separate
properties. Did they remain separate properties?
They did not. So Hasbro licenses Transformers, puts them together. They hire some folks from Marvel Comics to help them come up with all the names and character behaviors and traits. They work with Sunbow, a Korean animation company, to put the cartoon together. So they've got a cartoon, a comic, and these toys. And it's such a hit immediately in America that Japan decides to get on board and drops the Diaclone car robot and Microman change lines and converts them into Transformers. So every toy from the initial 1984 run of Transformers is a pre-existing toy from some other toy line.
Wow.
And my favorite little weird aside about that is that the toy lines that we're talking about, Diaclone and Microman, are actually connected in that both of those came from the Henshin Cyborg toy line, which is a cyborg that transforms with little swap-on parts, and that the Henshin Cyborg toy line comes from a figure where the core mold was based on a toy from the UK Action Man toy line, and the UK Action Man toy line is the UK version of Hasbro's G.I. Joe 12-inch tall figures. So Hasbro licenses their 12-inch tall molds to a toy company in the UK who makes Action Man, who make a mold that gets bought by Takara to make Henshin Cyborg, which spins off the Microman and Diaclone series, which eventually results in Hasbro buying back those designs and creating transformers.
Oh, crap. I'm down.
Got pretty close. I believe in you, Optimus Prime. You'll be able to take out Devastator. As for why they have human faces, because that's how they got designed. And again, keeping in mind that they came from two different toy lines, most of the...
Okay, I'm doing worse this time. Hold on.
A lot of the Diaclone figures don't have as human of faces. Like, Optimus Prime was a Diaclone character named Convoy. And if you see the ads, he's not one guy. There's like an army of these Convoy robots trucking along, and they have faces, but they've all got that mask
on them. Oh my gosh. I'm doing so much worse than I did the first time. What is going on? All right.
I love Lord Frightu says WWE wrestling has less convoluted storylines than Transformers licensing history. It gets even more weird there because you get into stuff like, so the 1985 line of Transformers that came out, they had used up all of the, not quite all, there's stuff like Ultra Magnus is based on a Diaclone car robot figure. But since it uses the Optimus Prime figure as a base, they didn't want to just reuse it immediately. But they'd used up so many of the initial molds, they basically ran around getting any transforming robot that they could. So that's why you wind up having, like, transforming robot bugs, and Skylynx is there, who turns into, like, a weird jet, and then the jet part turns into a mouth, and he's like a dinosaur. Robotech does not get involved. Robotech is its own whole complicated thing. Well, okay, a little bit, because in 1985, they licensed the rights to the Valkyrie model to create the character Jetfire, who they always have trouble re-releasing because his character design is totally the character design of the Valkyrie from Macross, which got used in Robotech. So the company that owns the rights to Robotech in America won't let them get too close to the original design. Jeff, your camera's all gray. I think that's fine. It's not gray.
So for a while, these two cameras were messed up, and the right-hand one was just gray for no reason, so I matched it with the left-hand one, and now the right-hand one is better, and so I'm gonna have to do it again.
It's not until 1986 and the Transformers movie that any figures were actually designed as Transformers. Up until then, every Transformer was them borrowing a mold from some other series and trying to keep up with demand for Transformers, which is another thing I love about them. X-Rogan says they're all Optimus, but only one is Prime. So, not quite. In Transformers, there's Optimus Prime. He's one guy. In the original series from which Optimus Prime is derived, Diaclone Car Robot, there are a ton of Convoy, which is the name of this character, of the figure in that series, characters. And all of them are...
Oh, I got so close!
You did.
Dunedain
mentions Beast Wars, which is a good series. Beast Wars manages to fit into the G1 continuity in a weird time travel-centric way. There's some episodes where you see original Transformers, which are huge compared to the Beast-sized figures. I think that's most of the history of Transformers up until now. Stuff, I can keep going. it helps explain stuff like later series tended to have these like unified gimmicks. You know, you'd have all of the Scramble City combiners being interoperable. They could all combine with one another, whereas earlier combiners like Devastator and Predaking can't do that kind of thing because they were from an earlier series where they weren't designed as Transformers in the first place. And there's more stuff you can go into, like the Brave series borrowing designs from Transformers and reusing molds, and I find the weird separations between Japanese and American series and how some series get ported over to the other country and some don't. So there's characters like Star Convoy that exist in Japan that we don't have in America. And then there's a few characters we have in America that they never got in Japan. Most of our series got ported over. But they tended to be redubbed and re-edited pretty aggressively, just like Americans get mad when it happens to a Japanese show. and treat it as pretty broad comedy. Better than GoBots. GoBots has its own whole thing where that's Machine Robo in Japan, and it's a totally different story and retools and all kinds of stuff. Hi Cadet asks about, what about Machinima's Go 90 New Combiner Wars? That series seems to be based, congrats Geoffrey.
Thank you.
On, it's loosely based on the current IDW story, but not completely because Megatron's not an Autobot in it. Megatron's an Autobot now.
Oh. Oh, what?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Okay, now I'm Bumblebee.
The Gundam stuff's pretty straightforward to me, because the Gundam stuff is just like, there's Gundam and there's some series, and they didn't tend to like license out or buy designs from other shows. Like, the most complicated Gundam stuff is Bandai doesn't often re-release Advance of Zeta figures or designs because they're part owned by Dengeki Hobby, because they were made together before Bandai owned Sunrise. Like, that's not nuts.
So there's a... I'm out of energy. I don't see an easy way to get more.
And so apparently I... credit scanner if you hit select.
What? Credit scanner?
Yeah, hit select.
What? What items, maybe? Credit scanner? Increase credits acquired.
I don't know what that is.
What are you talking about?
It's something said, like, hit select for credit scanner.
Oh. I mean, I guess I could. What I need is energy. I need ammunition. So, oh, yay! I succeeded with an A while feeling completely incompetent.
You did it!
Yay!
What's... hit left and right bumper to sticks in together at once.
It seems I should wait till there's an enemy nearby, and then I'll do that.
Oh, if that's fair.
Hello. I'm sure this is fine.
Click your sticks, click your sticks.
Nope, I want to have like enemies I'm actually fighting next to me. Oh, hello.
Starscream is High Cadet's favorite.
Oh yeah, Starscream was always my favorite character too.
So High Cadet's asking how Megatron became a good guy. Man, this is a long, complicated story. So, years ago in the current IDW comics, the war is over in the IDW comics. The 16 million year war between the Autobots and Decepticons is over. And frankly, it's like the most fascinating thing they could possibly have done for that series. Starscream is currently the leader of the survivors on Cybertron, and it's fascinating because there are a mixture of Autobots, ex-Autobots, ex-Decepticons, and Transformers who just left, who were like, man, fuck this war, and just left the planet in the first place. So they're all back there living together now. Which I just think is delightful. So with Starscream as the leader of Cybertron, Optimus Prime's on Earth, having recently declared the Earth is under his protection / semi-rule. He's a benevolent tyrant on Earth, which Earth is not super into.
Megatron!
Megatron was captured and tried for his crimes and was found guilty and was going to be put to death, but has worked out basically a weird work release thing where he's helping Rodimus. Rodimus is the pilot, is the captain of a ship called the Lost Light, which is searching for the Knights of Cybertron, who are these amazing ancient leaders of Cybertron who left millions and millions of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But these are all functionally immortal robots. There's no reason they have to be dead. And with everything in crazy chaos, Starscream's running the planet, Optimus Prime doesn't want to be in charge of anything anymore.
Yeah.
They're like, let's go find our ancient leaders and see if they can fix anything. There's no reason they might not be around. So they're off looking at those guys, looking for those guys, and Megatron is with them. And, man, read More Than Meets the Eye. More Than Meets the Eye is really, really good. It sounds weird, but it's a Transformers comic where they almost never transform, and it's more about just being a crazy sci-fi adventure story where these guys... It deals with the fun, crazy sci-fi premises of Transformers where it's like, so wait. You have giant, functionally immortal robot beings who have been involved in a 16 million year war that's over, and they now have to figure out how to live their lives and function in the universe? That's insane. And this is a series about that. Why are they at war in the first place, or why are they at war now? They're not currently at war. Galvatron, who is a completely separate from Megatron character in IDW, is fighting with Optimus Prime on Earth, but that's... The Autobot Decepticon war is over. And actually, it's currently Sentinel Prime starting some shit up. I'm not entirely up to date.
So I have not been, you know, keeping up, obviously, like you have, with Transformers. I just remember being really impressed when I was a kid, you know, because most of the stuff that you read when you're a kid is just... It's not, you know, oh, bad guys, oh, we defeated them, you know, it's about as far as it gets.
Right.
But,
Transformers,
and I expect,
guys die?
Yeah, I expected Transformers to be the worst of that, right? Because it's just a toy, you know, it's like, they're just there to sell toys, so of course, it's gonna be super lame. Instead, somebody was assigned to do the story for this, and they really gave a crap, you know? And I was like, and so it was like, it really, like... The book where Optimus dies is like really made me think as a kid, because I was like, I disagreed with his decision. Like he decided to die,
right?
And I thought he was making a stupid, terrible decision, but it made me think about it. It made me think about why I thought that and why he might have disagreed with me. And it, you don't get that out of, like, you know,
no, you don't.
Kids toy selling media usually.
Well, and that's so. High Cadet's asking about More Than Meets the Eyes. It's More Than Meets the Eye. If you get it on, like, Comicology, there's a one-issue thing called The Death of Optimus Prime, which, spoilers in advance, is not actually about the death of Optimus Prime.
Is it kind of like John dies at the end?
No, it is about, I think you were supposed to follow something.
No, I think I might be supposed to use my shield ability, shield killing ability on it.
Oh, cool. It is about the death of... So keeping in mind that Optimus Prime's birth name is Orion Pax, it is about the death of Optimus Prime. Not about...
Oh. The death of Orion Pax?
Not about the death of Orion Pax, yes. I really dig a lot of what the IDW series has done. So the backstory in the IDW series, and someone's asked, why are they at war... it's simpler in the classic continuity. It's basically just Megatron and the Decepticons wanted more Energon to live off of. So they went and got some.
So I keep picking up things. It seems like you should be able to equip them somewhere, but I can't tell.
Maybe...
Status? Weapons. Okay, here we go. So can I change it?
I don't know if your character... So you have empty slots. Maybe go to your empty slots.
Where are my empty slots? I don't see
right
empty slots.
Right bumper again.
I don't have any T.E.C.H.
Yeah, so they need their Energon. So, well, that one has a fire on it. Let's look at that one.
Yeah,
what happens if you hit A does nothing?
No.
B, X, Y?
I don't know what's going on. So I think I can change weapons. Oh. So I can decide if I'm using my flare gun or my basic missiles.
Okay. Flare gun seems cool.
I like fire.
Beat me to it, but yes. One of my favorite things about the IDW backstory is the Cybertronian government is super corrupt. They are awful, and they have been for generations. And in the early stages of the story, Optimus Prime and Megatron are on the same side. They are both fighting to overthrow the ridiculously corrupt Senate that rules Cybertron. And it's not until much later that it falls apart. That Megatron, who was originally like 100% in the right, he was an incredibly ill-treated, abused and put upon character who was fighting for justice and fairness.
I love that I can do extra damage and break through armor and stuff by driving up to somebody before attacking them.
Yeah. And that's right. So they're talking about how Megatron initially wanted the worker class to have better rights. But his thing went on. Megatron becomes convinced that only if he's in charge are things going to be okay. Everyone else who gets power, everyone who he thinks is a good guy, Sentinel Prime, Senator, Shockwave. Shockwave used to be a good guy. They all turned out to be, you know, fundamentally corrupt and unacceptable. And so only through him being the tyrant were we going to have peace. Peace through tyranny is one of the Megatron slogans.
Peace through tyranny?
Peace through tyranny. Being convinced, like, I am noble, I'm functionally immortal, I can just run this planet and be in charge forever. And I will maintain a fair, peaceful world. And I just have to kill everyone who dissents.
That's all I have to do.
Optimus, who is fighting back and saying we need to overthrow the Council and the Senate and maintain something more peaceful, winds up putting Optimus in charge. Which is great, because it gives them way more interesting backstories than just the Decepticons want energies. The Decepticons come from a place of ridiculous inequality that they're fighting against. And that they've, you know, an ideology has been taken too far. And that's a thing that happens.
Okay.
I really like the way the IDW series has messed with their backstories. And that Optimus and Megatron were friends for a pretty long time. Or if not friends, at least had aligned interests.
Looks like Energon, smells like Energon. Teletran 1, analyze.
Analysis complete. It appears to be a volatile form of Energon.
I think throwing it at that glowy thing was a good idea.
Yeah, I think I know what it's supposed to do with that glowy thing.
Megatron, serious?
Come on. Well, first we'll do this.
Oh, you've got generic ground soldiers. But yeah, as we said, Transformers has this history of creating more interesting than you'd expect backgrounds for characters. Like we mentioned Jetfire earlier. I love that canonically in the story, Jetfire and Starscream used to be friends before the war broke out. They just happened to be on other sides of the conflict after it happened.
Got a B. B's a passing grade. So, if you do really well in a test in Japan, do you get an S?
You do not. That's okay. Just from games.
Ah, I thought that was going to be it. What? Can I jump while I'm in a car? Well, I am a car, I should say. Okay, so I think I can get that thing if I jump at the right time?
Did I ever play Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Out of Manhattan? I played... There's an old Manhattan-themed NES game with Ninja Turtles that I've played, but I think TMNT Out of Manhattan might be a different game
than
you're talking about.
One more try, then I'm done trying this.
I still think you're supposed to throw Mega or the unstable Energon at that thing until it blows up.
Maybe so.
Also, there's a thing back there.
It seems like I threw it not very far. Okay, so yeah, that's not working. Oh, okay, it worked that time. Weird. Okay, cool.
You got some repair kits and a new melee weapon. There will be a thing on the left as you go forward. Like, if you turn around now.
I think that's my destination, my real destination. Wait, do I? What was that? Okay, I wonder if that will just bash me through all that stuff. Oh, okay, hold on.
Dunedain mentions Transformers Exodus is a fantastic primer on the beginnings of the conflict, yeah. They've got a lot of the stuff from the new series on Comixology for really reasonable prices. And nice collections of everything and backstories. More Than Meets the Eye is my personal favorite, but they're really all pretty darn great.
So the guy with the shield... Oh, wait, no. Hey! He just did the same move I was doing.
Son of a gun.
Oh. Nice.
X Rogan, I think, thought you might be dying. I thought his rip was about the fact that More Than Meets the Eye is ending, and it kind of is, but it's coming back immediately afterward as a new series, so... it's fine. It's coming back as Lost Light. And I'm plenty excited for that.
Oh, okay. Gotta make a hard turn.
So this feels very Platinum to me, and that it's very quick and action-y, and their level design's not the best, but the fights feel good, so...
Yeah, it's like they're not really even trying with the level design, it's just...
It's a series of hallways. And that's kind of all they're trying to do, so it's
and kind
okay.
of open areas. I like, you know, they kind of, they didn't try to do anything too fancy with the destructible stuff, they just like... an area starts out really busy, and then by the time your Transformers are done fighting there, it's flat.
It's kind of
all you need. See, did I miss anything over here? No. Yeah, it's like there's not a lot of, like, collectibles to search for or anything like that. You're just going to the next fight, really.
It's a little bit. There's been a little bit of, like, no, turn around, like, throw a thing over here. There's this collectible that you didn't necessarily have to find.
Yeah, but it's like they're big challenges, or they make it, you know, oh, this is interesting. You have to hit this thing and then run over here before they all disappear.
Yeah.
And it's not just like everything squirreled away. It's more like we decided to make a challenge out of this.
So High Cadet's talking about, apparently Out of Manhattan is the new TMNT game. It's a four-person brawler like the old arcade games. X Rogan says, if he recalls, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is originally a very dark story. Yes and no. Originally, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was a Daredevil homage. If you've watched the new season of Daredevil on Netflix, you've seen that there are these ninjas he fights against all the time called the Hand, which is where they got the name for the Foot Clan.
Yeah.
It was just a joke about the Hand.
Oh, crap.
But
yeah, no, I like the original, I actually got into properly, but that was one of them. I read the first three full graphic novels.
Yeah, and High Cadet mentions the IDW TMNT is dark. I would expect so. I haven't read it. I've heard good stuff about it. I just two kids and busyness, and as much as I loved Transformers as a kid and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Transformers are the ones that still interest me as an adult, because, you know, you can buy stuff like this, or you can spend a bunch of money for a really fancy Optimus Prime. Which I'm gonna start transforming now.
See if I can get these guys. Boom! It's like you gotta kill all of their shields before it's worth staying to fight them.
Right. Lord Frightus, is Stan Saki doing the IDW Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? I know he's worked on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles before, at least in passing. Like, they had Usagi Yojimbo even on the cartoon.
Yeah, they basically gave me this, like... I mean, my super is basically, like, just don't, just get out of whatever fight you don't want to do. You know?
What's your character's super?
Well, it's just, like, you kill so many people with it. It's really effective. And even works against sort of boss-ish things like this.
Well, Lambor's pretty cool. People are talking about which character from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was their first crush. It's mostly April, but no, Stan Saki didn't create the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Oh man, it's probably the first time in my life I've tried to know who created the Ninja Turtles and couldn't immediately recall it. It was
Eastman and Laird?
Eastman and Laird. Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird. Silent Wolf's first crush was Splinter. Dunedain's wife's was Leonardo.
Yeah, I thought April was pretty hot.
Yeah. Comic April with the fro?
I don't remember. Yeah, I think so, yeah. That comic April, definitely better than everything. I didn't like the cartoon when I was a kid because I had read the comics, and I felt the cartoon was just like making, you know, turning Michelangelo into this clown, giving them the colorful bandanas, and it just felt like it wasn't, you know. I liked that just everybody's got a red bandana.
You had read the serious version already.
Yes, exactly. It couldn't compare.
You weren't interested in this kid stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And I was just getting to the age where you care about whether something is kid stuff. You know, I was like, right. 11, 10, 11. I was like, no, I'm way too mature for this, you know, cartoon crap.
Right.
Plasma accelerators against you instantly.
Lord Frytus is saying between April O'Neil and Ratchet Hackwrench from Rescue Rangers, he has a weird thing about jumpsuits. Could be worse. I feel like as things like that go, talking someone into a jumpsuit's gotta be one of the easier things to pull off.
Oh, man. Gotta catch Megatron.
X-Rogan says, I never really understood why Shredder was evil. In my book, a dude with an outfit that awesome can't be evil. Transformers definitely suffered a little bit, not as bad as like G.I. Joe did for me, from the thing where the bad guy's aesthetic is so much cooler than the good guy's aesthetic. Like, He-Man.
Have I passed Megatron? I think I've passed Megatron.
You might well have.
I'm letting
Seems
him catch
fine,
up.
Though.
Oh, now I just auto hit him when he come up behind me.
Darn right. Watch yourself, Megatron.
Oh, man. Hey! I'm trying to chase the bad guy. Come on. Did he go here? I don't even know where he went. I'm probably going the wrong way.
Probably.
That's kind of my thing.
They call you Wrong Way Card.
All right, where are you?
Silent Wolf has added Daisy Duke as a first crush, which I think is probably true for a lot of people of the appropriate generation for Daisy Duke to have been.
Yeah.
If she was an option, I bet she was up there.
I was a little young for that. I'm having trouble thinking. I'm not sure who my actual, like, first, like, either fictional character or famous person crush was. Lady J, that's who it was.
Solid one.
Lady J.
Transformers G.I. High Cadet says Transformers G.I. Joe, the bad guys were always cooler. I think Transformers has some pretty awesome looking heroes. I think Optimus Prime in particular is a character design that is just undeniable and cool forever. That front windshield into
enormous pecs,
it just works so well. He just has that superhero look.
Ow! Wow, he took me down fast.
That Megatron.
Oh yeah, I'm auto-repairing. I've got an auto-repair kit. So, with the soundtrack, I can't help but think that that Megatron is attacking me with music, that he's like the Doof Warrior.
That's some pretty Doof Warrior-y music.
Yeah, seriously. Ah, Megatron! Nope.
So.
I keep forgetting to follow up with the proper vehicle attack.
Lord Frenchies says, truth be told, his childhood-defining cartoon was Ulysses 31, and he hopes one day he'll be the guy to make a game of it. I don't know.
No.
Ulysses 31.
Yeah, I remember there was a, The Mysterious Cities of Gold was a big favorite of mine.
Sure.
And there was Spartacus cartoon that was on Nickelodeon?
That I don't remember.
Oh, yeah, it was like this French cartoon about like people living in a hollow earth. And it's in a place where people don't have legs. They have these big, like enormous, like spheres, like blobby spheres that they sort of slug around on.
All right.
And like legs are like a surface world thing. And then like their world is dying or something. And, they've got to go up to the surface world to do something, and I've completely forgotten everything about it. So I finally found it, like, for sale somewhere, and I was so amazed, and sorry, I'm getting distracted by the game, as you can imagine. That's oh, fair. Man, I'm down. Oh, it's so
no
close.
More, no more auto heals.
No more auto heals. All right, so, but anyway, So I was able to find it, but it's only available in French. You can't get it in English. So what I have to do is learn French, and then I can enjoy this cartoon from my childhood.
I finished transforming Optimus Prime. There he goes. Lord Frenchies says there are more French cartoons than you'd think, and lists Care Bears, Inspector Gadget, and Mask.
Oh, Smurfs, too.
Lord Frenchies also says he can teach you French. Smurfs is Belgian.
Oh, sorry. It was in French.
It was in French. That's correct.
But yeah, the original word Smurf has like 12 letters or something. I mean, like the whole joke of the word is that it's making fun of the French language and how many letters you can actually cram into a word.
I think it's schtroumpf.
Yeah, schtroumpf, but like there's like certainly like four consonants at the end and three vowels and or something. It's kind of ridiculous.
You know that the modern zombie, as we depict zombies in like fiction, the first version of that is the Smurfs.
Oh, what, really?
Yeah, so the classic zombie. Yeah, X Rogan says Schtroumpfs, S-C-H-T-R-O-U-M-P-H-S. So the classic zombie is like the Haitian zombie, where it's like a person who has died and been brought back to life by a witch doctor in order to function as a servant. Like that is what zombie meant for most of history. And then the first version of the story is there's a Smurf story where I believe the Smurfs get an infection that turns them black, makes them aggressive, and causes them to bite other Smurfs who then become infected, turn black.
I feel like I remember
and bite
this.
Other Smurfs.
I feel like I remember seeing either in the cartoon or reading the. This is so familiar to me.
So, like, what we now think of as like standard zombie, brain dead, violent version of a person. Who infects others and spreads the disease. It was originally a Smurfs concept.
I used my super just right in his face.
That's awesome. And you got an A.
Yes.
And yeah, Lord Frenchies says the Black Smurf. Yeah. I'm not saying that the people who went on to create what we think of as zombies, like, stole it from the Smurfs. I don't think that they did.
It was just an early innovation in that story.
It was just like the first time anyone did that story that we've got record of was the Smurfs. And then that became how we think of zombies.
Yeah. Well, it's 1 o'clock, so I'm betting after this cutscene, we're probably going to call it quits. But I got to say, like, my hands are aching from how tensely I've been grabbing the controller. You know, this was that battle was hard, but I felt like I had all the tools I needed to, and I understood what was going wrong whenever I was defeated. Like, it's very difficult to make an action game that operates at this speed and still feels slick and like everything's going the way you intend it to. So I'm really impressed with this game. And yeah, if you're into Transformers, if you're into action games, like Platinum style action games,
yeah,
this is I definitely call this one a success.
How much does it run?
Now I don't know how much it is now. I got it for Steam sale prices, and so right. I don't remember how much it is. But if you check on Steam, it's a lot less than it was originally.
$60 game.
No, I think it was originally like $40, and now it might be down to like $20 or something. But I think I got it for like $10.
So especially on sale, like I can see some people being like, the level design in this is a little bit weak.
Yeah.
And I would agree with you. They spent all their time tuning the fighting, not building the levels.
Yeah. But they tuned the fighting, and the fighting felt good. So.
And the visuals look great. It's really fun to look at.
So I am kind of in Kansas, and you're kind of in Oz right now, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll have to mess with that. Oh, well, anyway, thanks everybody for being here. And
to set colors.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
See, it's not gray.
It's just kind of a little desaturated.
It's real desaturated.
So I'm going to cut.